Good evening, ladies. We are on week 45. Can you believe that we have 7 weeks left of journaling? Who would have thought that long ago we would have journaled this much right now? So, I just wanted to give you the topic, week 45. This is a tough topic. This is a topic where, let me see, hold on. Bev's asking me if I'm on here. This is a tough topic because we deal with this a lot, as women especially, I think. So the topic is, when I feel guilty. Do you ever feel guilty? Ever? Do you ever feel guilty about anything? From the smallest of things, from I could feel guilty today from eating 2 Jolly Pirate donuts and maybe a cinnamon roll too, I don't know, but I could feel guilty about doing those things. But what about feeling guilt? What is guilt? Why do we feel it? When is guilt good? When is guilt bad? We're going to talk about that tonight, and I probably will give you a little more verses than I normally do, but I really want to drive this home for you, because women are the worst to carry a load, a guilt-bearing load with them everywhere they go. So, first of all, I did some research on guilt, and the definition of guilt, it's a negative emotion or feeling that you have when you've done something wrong. Now, that's the good guilt. That is the guilt that calls us to repentance. I'm thankful for that guilt, for when I do wrong, you get that heaviness in your heart, and you get that feeling in the pit of your stomach, and you know then that you're going to have to go say you're sorry. Sometimes it's better not to do the wrong thing, because it's harder, even harder, to go apologize to the person maybe that you have wronged. Have any of you ever felt guilt before? You've done something wrong, you've said something that you shouldn't, you got caught in the act of talking about somebody, your phone butt dialed somebody and you were talking about them. Have you ever felt that kind of guilt? And again, that is good guilt, because that guilt brings us to repentance. What do we do when we feel that, when we feel that kind of guilt, when we have actually done something wrong, when we have committed a sin? That guilt leads us to repentance. And what repentance means, it's more than saying you're sorry. Repentance means to seek forgiveness and turn away from actually asking God to forgive you, asking the person to forgive you, and turn away from doing that, to not go back to doing that anymore, is what real repentance is. So as I was studying this, I'm going to read you some facts that studies have shown about guilt. And I couldn't believe some of these things. One of them is, studies show that we spend at least 5 hours a week feeling guilty. Wow, what could you do with 5 extra hours of not feeling guilty? What do you do when you're feeling guilty? Do you obsess about things? Do you clean your house frantically? Do you overeat? 5 hours a week. Ladies, we don't have enough time to do that. We do not have enough time to have 5 hours of feeling guilty, especially when we've already confronted that, we've repented from that, we've apologized from that, and we're trying to move forward. Now, it says unsolved guilt is like having a snooze alarm in your head. Do you have unresolved guilt? Have you done something wrong to somebody or wronged somebody, and you are still living with unresolved guilt because you have not apologized to them or you have not tried to make it right? And believe me, those conversations are hard to have. They make me sick when you actually have to tell somebody you're sorry because you have done wrong. It's about humility. It's about letting go of ourselves and doing what the heart of Christ wants us to do. So unresolved guilt is like a snooze alarm in your head, meaning you can get away with it for a few minutes, but then all of a sudden it comes back into your mind. It's continually there reminding you. And that is good guilt, because that is reminding us of what we need to do with the actions that we have wrongly done or taken. Guilty feelings cause you to not be able to think straight. I can totally believe that, because in our mind, in our subconscious mind, or in our mind, our conscious mind too, you know, we're going to continually thinking about the thing about thinking all the time, thinking about what we've done wrong or what we've not done right and what we need to do. Now, here's the thing. Guilt can come from not only doing something wrong, but not from not doing something as well. Knowing that you should have helped someone, knowing that you should have done something that you didn't, that's another form of guilt too. Guilt can make you refuse to enjoy life. I mean, guilt can make you feel so bad that you think, well, which leads to the next point, it can cause you to self-punish yourself. I have wronged somebody, therefore I'm going to punish myself by not allowing myself to enjoy life. So here's the thing, seek forgiveness, repent from it, and make it right with the person. Don't continue to hold on to that. Make a genuine repentance and a genuine apology and get rid of that guilt, and do not let it hold you hostage. Quit trying to self-punish yourself. A lot of times guilt causes us to avoid the person we've wronged. Okay, I can see avoiding the person that we've wronged if we've not made it right. But you know what? Even after you make it right, it's still uncomfortable, isn't it, to go around that person again that maybe you have wronged, or for them to be around you. I want to turn this around just for a minute. What we don't want to do as Christian women, as Christian leaders, as servants of the King, what we don't want to do is we don't want to intentionally make people feel horrible about being around us after they've done something wrong to us. We don't want people to feel that. You don't like that feeling. We want to make, if someone makes a genuine apology to you, tells you that they're sorry and that they didn't mean to hurt you, you need to forgive them and let them go. I was having a conversation with somebody about a month ago, and we were talking about this relationship and how this that some things had happened in the past that had hurt this person. And they said, you know what? If getting back with this person means this, they're going to have to prove to me all these things. And I said, wait a minute. So God makes you prove to him every single time that you maybe mess up and do something small wrong or something big? Does God hold you that accountable to that? And you know, that person said, you know, that's kind of eye-opening. So when people ask forgiveness, you need to give them forgiveness just like Christ gave it to you. You don't want to be the person that causes them to carry that bloat of guilt over their head. Get over what one has done to you. What choice do we have? Holding on to that only causes us to not feel well, to not be well. It makes our life miserable, and it also makes the other person's life miserable. So let's move past that guilt. Okay, the next one says, guilt trips make you feel resentful. How many of you have ever been on a guilt trip? How many of you have put somebody on a guilt trip? And how many of you know a guilt tripper? They always know how to make you feel guilty. Oh, well, okay, that's fine. Or just that feeling that you get that makes you feel guilty when you've done nothing wrong. Have you been there before? That is a horrible feeling. Don't be a guilt tripper, and don't let anyone guilt trip you, especially the enemy. Here's the one that you're all going to love. Feeling guilty makes you feel heavier. Studies have shown that women assess their weight as being heavier than they are, and physical activities require more effort than a person who is not experiencing guilt. Think about that. Guilt associates to our body, to our hormones, to our functions, causes us stress and anxiety and depression. All of these things is what guilt does. And I've wrote a couple of notes here for you, and I've actually got four little points that I want you to think about. When you're feeling guilty, about something, what is the first thing that you should do? We know exactly what the first thing we should do is exactly get on our knees and repent to God and just tell him to just open our eyes and to help us get through what we've done. And then the next step is, if we need to go to somebody else and apologize, we need to do that too. We need to get up and get up. You know what? I've messed up. I've made a mistake. I'm so sorry. I talked about you. I did this. And you know, it was just out of pure, I don't know what it was out of, but I am so sorry. And that was so ugly of me. And that is not who I am. And I've already asked God to forgive me. And now I'm asking you to forgive me. You know, and that is so important for us to do, because that relieves a load from us. But what happens if the other person still wants to hold that over your head? Here's the thing, that person is not letting, this is where forgiveness comes in and unforgiveness. So that person is literally holding themselves hostage to that guilt, to the thing that you've done to them, trying to hold you hostage by guilt tripping you. We cannot live under that dark cloud. We need to realize that when we ask God to forgive us, when we turn away from what we're doing, when we ask that person to forgive us genuinely in our heart and we mean it, we need to be able to move forward. Now, if that person can't move forward, we really need to pray deep and hard for that person because they are struggling with something. It causes a lot more effort to carry that around, to want to harbor those feelings about someone who has done us wrong. And I'm speaking to me and you tonight too. If somebody else does us wrong, accept their apology and forgive them and set them free and set yourself free. So here's the things I want you to remember. So when God, when you feel guilt, there's so many verses about this in the scripture, and I was really, pleasantly surprised of all the scriptures there are about guilt, about sin, about things, about what God intends for us to feel and what God intends for us to do. So here's the thing. The first thing is I want you to remember this, that out of sight, Isaiah 38:17 says this, you have put all my sins behind your back, out of mind. For I will forgive their wickedness and remember their sins no more. Jeremiah 31:34. Out of reach, you will tread your sins underfoot and hurl all our iniquities into the depths of the sea. Micah 7:19. Out of existence, I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and remembers your sins no more. Isaiah 43:25. Sometimes we are guilty for the wrong reasons. As these little studies show, we want to punish ourselves for things. We think that being sorry and repenting is not enough. Maybe the guilt comes from a past situation that the person is no longer living. Maybe it's something that you can't go back and change. I want you to ask yourself these questions right here tonight. Why am I feeling guilty? Why are you feeling guilty? Why do you feel guilty about what you're feeling guilty about? Is it unresolved forgiveness? Is it unresolved repentance? Have you taken care of that situation with God and with the other person? Why are you feeling guilty about what you're feeling guilty about? And how do you feel when you're feeling guilty about what you're feeling guilty about? Is it a pleasant feeling? Absolutely not. It is disgusting. It is such an ugly feeling, and it just absolutely just hangs over your head, this gloom and doom. The next thing I want to ask you is, can you do anything else to fix or change what you're feeling guilty about? This is a serious question. You need to ask yourself this. Is there anything I can physically do besides repenting, asking God to forgive me, asking the person to forgive me, doing whatever I may need to do to make it right? Maybe you needed to go fix something for somebody, or maybe you wronged somebody in a different situation. Have you done all that you can do? Is there anything else you can do? If that answer is no, then the enemy is trying to guilt trip you and cause you to harbor all those feelings that's not necessary. If you have done what is right, you need to seek forgiveness, repent, get it right with the other person, and move on. The other question is, if others try to guilt trip you about the past, that means that they're in bondage, right? And you don't need to be there with them if you've done everything you possibly can. And here's some scriptures. Like I said, I usually would not read these many scriptures. I'm just going to go through them quickly for you. But I want you to know that Jesus died on the cross. He served as a ransom for your soul, for forgiveness. He did not intend for us to live as a guilty person or the guilty people or to carry that burden or load. So whatever it is, there may be things that you're feeling guilty about that's even out of your control, things that you did not even do, things that you cannot even help, but you may still be bearing some burden about that. Why are we holding ourselves hostage with guilt when it's not guilt that's necessary? So here's these scriptures. I want you to listen to this, and I'm going to move quickly through them. John 3:17, for God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. God didn't come to condemn you or me or to cause us to feel guilty. He came to save us. But that first ounce of guilt in our conscience is what he embedded in us to seek repentance, to know that we are lost and that we need to have him as our Savior, and we need to ask him to come into our heart to forgive us of our sins, and we need to believe that. The next scripture is this, for he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. That is amazing. Him who had no sin to be sin for us. The third one is, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. Ephesians 1:7. The fourth one, come now and let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Isaiah 1:18. Number five, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9. Number six, for I will be merciful to the their unrighteousness and their sins and their lawless deeds. I will remember no more. Hebrews 8:12. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he moved our transgressions from us. Psalm 103:12. Number eight, there is therefore no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Romans 8:1. And then the last one is number nine. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. I love that scripture. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Are you living with the old person even though you've been saved? Or are you letting go and putting the new person on? There is so much freedom in not feeling guilty. There is so much freedom and salvation. There is so much freedom to know that you were held hostage by the enemy and God used Jesus to pay the ransom for your soul to set you free so that you don't have to live in that bondage anymore. Now the enemy, absolutely, the enemy is, he is the greatest guilt tripper ever. He will do everything he can to get into your mind to cause you to live in a past situation that you've already taken care of and it's been nailed to the cross and it's gone. Stop living there and stop living free. We don't have 5 hours a week to be living in guilt. We don't have 5 hours a week to attribute that kind of time to. I know that we've all made past mistakes. Maybe we haven't been the mom we should have been, or the daughter we should have been, or the wife we should have been, or the friend we should have been. There are things that I know that we look back and we say, oh, I wish I had never done that. I wish I had never done that. But can you go back and fix it? Can you go back and change time? You can only change how you move forward. And again, the most greatest thing, the thing that will set you free from the guilt, is true repentance, turning away from whatever it is and seeking the forgiveness of the person that you have wronged or the situation, whatever it may be. There are things that we cannot go back and change. People who have passed away, people that we can't make it right. You know, I've read so many times that people write letters out to people. They go visit them and just get it off their chest. But here's what, when you know that there is nothing physically, anything else that you can do, then and you've got to let it go. You've got to start living in that freedom of Christ that he gave for you. Listen, think about this. You know, you've watched the show on TV before where a child's been kidnapped, right? And the kidnappers are saying, the ransom is this. I want this much money. And what happens? A parent will do anything in the world to try to come up with that money to pay the ransom to get their kid back. The enemy is holding you hostage. The sad part is that God has already paid the ransom. You've already been set free, but you are choosing to be held into that bondage of guilt. Guilt is bondage when it's not causing us to seek repentance. So there is a good guilt and there is a bad guilt and there is a season of guilt. And this is where the enemy wants to keep you. If he can keep you focusing 5 hours a week on feeling guilty about things that's already been taken care of, things that you can't control, things that you can't fix, things you can't do anything about anymore, he is winning. He is taking 5 hours of your life. 5 hours that you could spend investing in God, investing in others, investing in your family, and investing in yourself. Think about that. So this week, the topic is when I feel guilty. Like again, there are so many things that you can find in the scripture about verses of guilt. Take time to read those because when that cloud of guilt wants to come over your life and hang out again, you need to remember who bought and who paid for you, who set you free, and then you go through those steps. The questions are again, why am I guilty? Why am I feeling guilty? And why am I feeling guilty of what I'm about? Is it legitimate guilt? Is it real guilt? Is it something I really need to be feeling guilty about? If it is, seek repentance and seek forgiveness from the friend or person or whatever the situation has been that you've done. And then have you done everything you possibly can do to fix it? Yes, if you can't fix, if there's nothing else you can do, you have got to move on past that. And remember, those who you may have offended or hurt may not be so easily to forgive, but you have to keep moving forward. You cannot let them hold you hostage either. You've been set free and they need to be set free and you need to be praying now for them to let it go and to be set free. So as you progress through this upcoming week, It is going to be a tough week. I know we have elections coming up. This is a time when we all need to be in unison and prayed about the right decisions to be made. But I want to give you a little bit of encouragement. No matter what happens on election day, God is still on the throne. It doesn't matter. We still serve the risen Savior who has the keys to death and hell, and we are living through Him in through victory, not for victory, but through the victory that He has already won for us. We have that assurance, and that should get us through more than anything. I want you to let go of things that you need to let go of. I want you to start feeling freer and lighter and being able to breathe a whole lot more. So this week, take time to really dig deep and find the scriptures about guilt. You can search, there's so many of them. Write them down, and when that cloud of guilt tries to come over you, go back and read those scriptures and remind yourself of who you are and whose you are, and so that you can live that free life. And last of all, don't guilt trip anybody. Don't be a guilt tripper. The enemy is the greatest guilt tripper. We do not want to be anything like the guilt tripper. We want to be more like God. So this week, no guilt tripping. Don't be one. Don't put anybody under. And don't be guilt tripped this week.